please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Apollo Tyres stock remained under pressure today. Now, this was on the back of minority shareholders voting against the reappointment of Neeraj Kanwar as the managing director of the company. Now, we're given to understand that the high compensation given to Neeraj Kanwar in financial year FY18, despite a fall in the company's profitability, was one of the main triggers behind shareholders voting against this resolution. Sonia Shenoy joins us now for more on this. Sonia, minority shareholders were clearly not very happy about that high salary. What else have you picked up?
Oh, absolutely. And the remuneration is staggering. As you rightly pointed out, on the 12th of September, 27% of shareholders voted against the reappointment of the MD, Neeraj Kanwar. And the reason cited was the staggering high remuneration. So we tried to dig down to find out what exactly the remuneration is. It is disproportionate to the kind of growth that the company has seen. The company has undergone a slowdown, but the remuneration has not. So here are the numbers. Neeraj Kanwar's remuneration as per FY18 annual reports stands at almost 45 crores, including the commission. Onkar Kanwar's remuneration stands at 42.8 crores. So the father-son duo combined gets a salary of almost 88 crores. Now, the FY18 profits that they reported was 622 odd crores. This means that Neeraj Kanwar's salary forms 7.2% of the FY18 profits. Remember, SEBI has a rule that if you take home more than 2.5% of profits, then you need a shareholder approval, and that's why the board has gone for the shareholder approval. Onkar Kanwar's salary forms 6.8%. So put together, the father and son draw home 14% of the FY18 profits, and that is where the shareholder ire has come from. The ratio of Neeraj Kanwar's remuneration alone to the median remuneration of the company's employees is 940x. So as per the SEBI formula, Neeraj Kanwar should be taking home about 15.5 crores, which is 2.5% of profits, but he's taking home 45 crores, which means that he's taking home an excess of 29.4 crores as compared to what the SEBI formula is. So basically, Apollo Tyres had to take shareholder approval in order to go ahead with this remuneration. So they are not violating any rules just yet. But what this makes us sit up and take notice is that shareholders, minority shareholders, institutional shareholders are questioning the decisions that promoters are taking with respect to, issues like compensation, etc. Back to you.
All right, Sonia, thank you very much for joining in. Now, here's some action from the Supreme Court, which refused to interfere in the case against five activists over the Bhima Koregaon violence and rejected their demand for a court-monitored special investigation team to probe this matter. Now, in a 2-1 majority order, the court extended the house arrest of the five activists by 4 weeks and said that their arrest is not due to dissent. But Justice Chandrachur issued a dissenting order, slamming the police for selectively leaks to the media and trying to influence public opinion. Ashmit Kumar, who was at the court, joins us now with more details. Ashmit, take us through the majority verdict and the dissent that has come in from Justice Chandrachur.
So, in what is clearly the big takeaway here, this is a 2-1 order, and by virtue of this being a majority, a 2-1 order, the voice of the two judges will prevail, and that is clearly that has been clear that as of right now they do not see the police action as being as designed for quelling dissent. The big takeaway essentially is that there will be no quashing of their arrests. There will not even be an SIT that has been sought by the petitioners, and that the trial remedy continues to be available, that they can seek a trial going forward. Now, the Apex Court's observations were very, very clear that there is nothing material in the allegations that have been raised. The claims are vague and unsubstantiated. That the arrests are not owing to political allegiances or dissent. And on the back of that, the Apex Court has held that prima facie, they believe there is a legitimate case that the Pune police might have, and they've allowed the Pune police to go ahead and investigate this case. But as you rightly pointed out, there is an interesting twist here. Justice Chandrachur has issued a dissenting verdict. He's clearly said that he refuses to agree with the majority view that the Maharashtra police selectively leaked information to cause a media trial, and that these actions of the Maharashtra police to ensure that the reputation of those activists is in fact hurt, points at lack of impartiality, raises questions about impartiality of the probe, and on the back of that, he had directed the constitution of an SIT. However, the problem is that this is a minority order and hence does not prevail. The majority view continues to be in force as of today, which is essentially that the house arrest has been extended and the trial will continue and there is no SIT as has been sought by the petitioners. Back to you.
All right, Ashpit, thank you. But just hold on. There was another huge decision taken by the Supreme Court today. The apex court has thrown open the doors of Lord Ayyappa's temple in Sabarimala to women of all age groups. Now, this has come as a landmark verdict in a 4-1 majority verdict by the constitutional bench. The apex court upheld the rights of women to worship in places of their choice. Interestingly, the only woman on the bench was also the only dissenting voice. Justice Indu Malhotra, in her verdict, said, and I quote, "Constitutional morality in a pluralistic society gives freedom to practice even irrational customs." End of quote. Ashmit, thank you for joining us back again. Take us through this order and again the dissent coming from the only woman on the bench.
Indeed, that's an interesting twist as well. But of course, the big landmark judgment coming through, making it very, very clear that as far as any provision that is antithetical to the concept of equality, runs contrary to the Constitution, deserves to be struck down. And on the back of that, what the apex court has done is that it has thrown open the gates of the Sabarimala temple to women of all ages. Now, the judgment is quite clear. It holds that the Lord Ayyappa devotees do not form a separate religious denomination, that the discrimination of women based on biological factors is not constitutionally sustainable, that these exclusionary practices are tantamount to treating women as untouchables and hence cannot be allowed to exist. Justice Chandrachur as well contributed here. He added that individual dignity cannot be subordinate to morality of the mob, that religion cannot become a cover to deny women the right that they seek in terms of fulfillment with respect to their faith, that such exclusionary practices based on menstruation is a violation of the dignity of women. And here is where it gets interesting. Justice Indu Ban, the only woman judge on the bench, was interestingly the only one to disagree. She clearly held that the right of equality sought by women runs contrary to the right of worship of those devotees, and that notions of rationality and logic cannot be imported as far as religious practices are concerned. But then again, this is a 4-1 verdict. The minority view, though it's there, does not affect the operation of the order. The operation of the order stems from the 4 judges who concurred. Then right. As far as the entry of women in Sabarimala is concerned, the doors will have to be thrown open. Back to you.